Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our 20th episode of The Bronze Age. If you haven't joined us before, we try to focus on Bronze and Silver League, Hero League matches, and try to help the viewers who submitted the replays find those areas where they can improve and climb up the ladder. Today we have a Silver ETC on Haunted Minds. Submitted by Giggle Schmack, and we'll jump straight into that one. His email said that it was a very close game, and he thinks that there's plenty of learning opportunities in here. So hopefully this will be a good one to look at here. We did have a balance patch today with Varian getting hit by a nerf, Murky getting hit by a nerf, Mouth with some minor nerfs, Tychus got a couple nerfs. So it'll be interesting to see how that plays out. We have some interesting... So first things first, whenever we load into these older replays, the sound is always way too high. So we will turn that down. Make sure, or let me know if my volume is okay in the stream. And let's go ahead. So we are on the blue team. There's Giggle Schmack on ETC. I think Knight's actually on my friends list too, so that's ironic that that he's there. But anyway, so we have a solo tank, double support, double assassin comp over here. So ideally we want our Butcher and our ETC to be on the same page here. That's a pretty long stun lock between ETC and Butcher. And when you're ETC, just remember that an often underutilized part of his kit is his that he gives attack speed to allies when you use abilities close to them. So if you can, try to hit that self-heal near Butcher or Vala. Those are going to be the heroes that are going to benefit from it the most. So try to keep that in the back of your head. And on the other side, we have a very interesting comp with a Artanis, Diablo, Murky, Samuro, and Asmodan. So we need to keep aware that we can't just let Asmodan push the whole game. You guys should have enough damage and lockdown to take him down easily enough. And Butcher should really try to maximize Murky kills. One of the ways you counter Murky is by, in Butcher's case, it counts as a full kill for the meat stacks, right? So if Butcher focuses on repeatedly killing that Murky, it'll allow him to farm up his meat stacks faster. And then the other thing to be aware of is if the Samuro player should be murking a lot, so that's something that you guys need to be aware of here. So let's jump right in. Yeah. Nivala's a little bit of a worry wart here. That's a good... That Giggle Schmack, you said what I just said. Butcher can counter him. And Butcher should try to be farming Murky for that meat, right? Because Butcher is weak early, but if he can get his stacks, he becomes an absolute monster once he finishes his quest. So the initial here is you guys, unless somebody rotates faster, are going to miss some soak in the bottom lane. Probably with this comp, I would use Tassadar, I suppose, as a solo laner. Is probably your best bet there. But either way, one of you guys needs to come down here. I'm going to turn the volume up just a little bit. Oh, and the other thing we were going to start doing is being in the point of view of our hero, which is ETC. So here's that. That way we can see... So that's one of those things right there. Don't just power slide for the sake of power sliding. Make sure the follow-up is there, because otherwise you put yourself in this situation where you're just getting burned and body slammed. And that's just a lot of free damage you don't need to take. And with this comp as it sits right now, with your little mini comp here, Butcher and Tassadar, early game Butcher with... I mean, looking at the three people in lane with you, there's no real squishies, so you guys will probably have a little bit of a hard time securing a kill. So you probably shouldn't even worry about it. Just soak the lane, clear it as best as you can without taking free damage. There you go, stun him out of the laser. That's a good stun. Body block, body block. There you go, that's some good gut body block. Excellent job. Nicely done. Page here or not. This is one of the things you want to try to do in Hero League if you can, and it's hard to do sometimes, especially in lower tier play, is get everybody moving in the same direction. You can really have a lot of people having different ideas of what is best to do. So anything you guys can do to keep your team moving in the same direction is an absolute good thing. So Vala right now is staying in top to keep tabs with Murky. That's just fine. And you guys need to be aware that Artanis can pop in here. You know, he's hovering around this entrance. Okay, now you can see, let's check our minimap, right? This is something we want to be doing constantly. As you can see that they're down here. Only Murky is showing, Vol is keeping tabs on Murky, that's just fine. But you can see that they're collecting skulls, so you guys know that they're down here. So it could be definitely a little dangerous to be in twos, because if they find you four on two, that could be trouble. So that's something you want to be aware of. You have no idea where they're at. You have to assume that they're in the top part of it, or at least they were, because those skulls are missing. However, this should be... Yeah, get down here on Asmo. If you get there fast enough, there's your kill. I like that you're on the Asmo. Secure the kill, well done. Now try to peel for Butcher a little bit. Back down. Oh, maybe a free kill on Diablo here. But you guys are a little light on damage, but... With enough lock-in, you should be able to get it. There you go. See, now with Butcher down here, you guys should be able to burn through this golem here pretty quickly. And that's, by the way, what you just did there, Giggle Schmack, that's what I wanted to see, making sure you give Butcher your attack speed. Anytime you use an ability, you're going to give... See, that time you're out of range. You hit Tassadar immediately, You want to make sure you hit Butcher with that little attack speed. It'll allow him to burn down the golem that much faster. As you can tell, if you've given it to him, if when you hit your E, you get the little yellow thing on the base of their hero. So a nice early win here. Picked up a free quarter kill. That's probably the real Samuro. Yeah, one of you guys at least needs to be bottom so you don't miss the soak. There you go, Giggle Schmack. Nice job. And it's okay to only send one down there to defend because theirs is so much weaker. If you guys want to push this, that's fantastic. Now body block him out, body block him out. Oh no, Diablo, turn the tide. Your killing spree has ended. The Rockstar range is pretty short. It's not very big at all. They need to be pretty close to you. And that's something, that's just one of the little things on ETC that gets overlooked a lot, is that attack bonus. And when you have an auto attacker, especially on, like, in the context of a team fight, it can be very easy to lose track of that. But especially on bosses and mercs, you want to make sure you're maximizing that. You know, in a team fight, you're power sliding and face melting all over the place and worrying about positioning and peeling and... And, you know, just that's one of those things that's really easy to get lost in the shuffle. But on mercs, bosses, objectives, anything like that, immortals, you want to make sure you're doing everything you can to maximize that, that race. Good body blocks, trying to hold that Diablo in there. I don't know, tower dive! Oh, no! Very dangerous. Now that would have been 100% more okay if the minions were there to tank it. It ended up being not a big deal, but you gotta be very careful. Oh, this is actually the pre-Murky rework, so this is old-school Murky. See, now it looks like something we want to be aware of here in Asimov. It looks like he might be holding his laser till after you power slide, since that's really your best way to interrupt him. So try to be aware of that, and make sure that you have that power slide available to interrupt that laser, if you can. If you can. So... Ultimate Selection, ETC, has two of the certainly most viable heroics. Mosh Pit is definitely the choice du jour, I think, at the lower levels because it's one of those heroics that can just crush a late game team fight and win. But when you're deciding what you want to heroic you want to choose, I tend to default to Mosh Pit unless they have too many counters. And in this case, the counters they have are Apoc, and the swap won't counter it, but it'll move you. So, that's one way to make sure you get some more. And see, that's the Apoc counter right there. So, anytime you don't get Diablo in the ultimate, you're gonna get counter with the Apoc. So. When you try to use it in a team fight, try to catch Diablo in it if you can, and then they really shouldn't have a counter for it. Oh, you're down here. I thought you were leaving. There's the Diablo. Well, that's something. Now, what Red is doing on here is a perfectly viable strat on Haunted Mines, is to sometimes ignore the objective. You can win it by doing it that way, but your team needs to be on the same page with you, and it doesn't really look like Red Team is on the same page with that. Because Asmo and Murky are trying to do it. However, it doesn't seem like the rest of the team was there with him.
Excuse me.
Okay, so now this is an area that we need to be careful when you go down there. Looking at the minimap, we have zero vision on anybody, the enemy team. You kind of have to assume that they're down here, other than Murky, who's probably up here near his egg somewhere. So if it were me, I am assuming that there are four people at this boss. So you and Lily do not want to simply ride in there by yourselves. You need to wait for your teammates to come. And if they don't, then don't go down here, because you're just putting yourself in a situation where something bad is likely to happen. So don't go in here just by yourself. There you go. 1, 2, 3, 4. And with that Artana swap, you got to be doubly, doubly careful. There we go. Now your team has arrived, but the big death laser has channeled you out. Nice water dragon by Lily there. So that worked out okay because your teammates were on their way, but you... excuse me, I'm still getting over a cold. You have to be very careful anytime you're kind of knowingly going into a situation where you're going to be outnumbered like that. Could be a real recipe for disaster, especially if they would have really locked in on you after that Artana swap.
The golems rise, but be wary. Yours is
fine. Now we have a big scary butcher, because you can see that axe is glowing, and that's what we want right there. Nice peels. Don't chase, you got these snow clones doing damage on your guys back here. So now that you have a butcher that finished his quest, you really want to see if you can set up your butcher. Serve the bad guys to him on a platter is what you want. And you can even kind of see the strategy I was saying of almost ignoring the skulls, because the other team is winning structurally despite the fact that you guys won the first two. And this is not a good idea for Tassadar to just dive in here. But even though you guys won the first two golems, you're actually behind structurally. And that's a reflection of the Asmo and the Murky, who have been largely ignoring the skulls and pushing out these guys. Now remember, Samuro still takes damage when he's in his spin like that. Now the reason that was not a great mosh was because Vala was dead and Butcher did not follow up on it. You want to make sure that your damage is around to follow up on it. Now try to follow him in there if you can. I know your Q was on cooldown there. But since he hasn't really been following up when your engages, maybe do it backwards. See if you can follow up on his engages. If you can lock an opponent down in front of Butcher for longer, that's a great idea. Because he hasn't really been jumping in with you. He's been kind of selective about that. So because Butcher's a killing machine when he does his quests, see if you can follow him instead of vice versa. That's just one of those in-game adjustments we can try to make.
Death stirs within the mines. Shall you breathe the darkness?
There you go. I like that. Got in there, throw out your face melt, get out your squishy safely. Now this is a 5-on-4 though. And now you guys have pressure on the core down here. This is not really ETC's strength. It's going to take him a little while to do this over, say, Vala, especially if you don't go his... What is his 7 called? The one where he does damage in a small area when he uses abilities around him. If you don't take that talent, ETC's wave clear is not particularly good. Oh, Butcher, get in there. There we go. Nice. You need to queue on Asmo or get out of range. Yeah. Nice. However, your guy's core at 85%. And so nobody is accounting for Murky, so Murky's in the process of getting a free keep here. Anytime you have Asmo, like Asmo Murky, you just have to account for that split push. That's one of the reasons they're so effective at lower tiers of play, is that some players in the bronze and the silver, they don't have good enough map awareness to account for those split pushers and punish them. So they just kind of dive away and get free structures, which is not what you want. I mean, you guys are winning. I mean, 15 kills to 4. You guys are winning the team fight, but look at the structural disadvantage. Heal for Vala, heal for Vala. There you go. Butcher's probably dead. This is actually my problem with this map generally, is you guys are winning the kills, 15 to nothing, you've won all of the objectives, and they've actually secured a lead in this game by completely ignoring the objective, and that shouldn't really ever be the case. Still on the puffer fish. Don't let him get the free keep. See, look at this. Samuro, between Samuro getting Merc camps, because that's what he's doing, and Asmo and Murky just having this constant, relentless pressure, it's really putting you guys on your back foot. Now, the advantage that you guys have, if you can stay alive and continue to kill them, as the games go longer and these death timers get longer, hopefully you punish them as you continue to kill them more. This is when you want the attack speed on Butcher. So if you guys get a teamfight win here, you want to get that top keep. That's going to do a lot to equalize this pressure. And probably for the rest of this game, you guys are almost going to have somebody back accounting for Murky and Asmodan. Now keep in mind, if you're a ranged damage dealer, so not right here, when there's a great mosh pit. When Samuro goes his Bladestorm, he is unstoppable, but he still takes damage. He can be killed. Alright, so now you guys need to get something here. You can't leave Murky on core. So one person needs to go deal with Murky, and the rest of you guys need to find some way to get map pressure on here. Whether it's taking a keep wall or a bunch of mercs, whatever. But somebody needs to deal with Murky. All right,
your core is under attack, heroes.
Well done.
The damned shall soon return.
Valhalla, you got him! Oh, that was so close. She was like literally less than an auto attack away from finishing Samuro. That's heartbreaking. So now, no, without your level 7 wave clear talent, it's driving me crazy that I don't remember what it's called. Hold on, I have to look it up. It's gonna drive me bonkers. Echo Petal. If you don't take Echo Petal at 7, ETC has not a lot of wave clear. And I'm almost positive you did not. You didn't. So this would have gone a lot faster with Echo Petal. So one of you guys has to be on constant murky duty. Yeah, somebody has to be there.
Your call is under attack, heroes.
Yeah, now you guys have to be back. And by the way, as Butcher right here, you can see your team's hearthing back. You have to be patient, because if Butcher dies before his teammates get here, that's really bad. Just waiting the 5 or 6 seconds till they get here is the right move. Nice dive there, though. Stun him in there. Nice. Under the core. Well done. Nice storm shield. Okay, now you guys need to leave one person on murky duty and go get a key. Go do something. There you go. Good call. I agree. Keep one person back to deal with the murky and everybody else. You're not going to be able to go all the way with this, I don't think. But at the minimum, you want to... And this is exactly what I was saying a few minutes ago. If you guys keep killing them like you are, when these death timers get long like that, that's when you start punishing them. Oh, especially because they don't have a wall up here. You definitely want to keep out of this. Right now you have 10 seconds before Asmo is up and 15 before Samuro is up, and then you guys are on roughly equal footing. See, I think if you guys would have just rushed the keep and not worried about the merc camps, or the minion waves, you would have gotten more done there. This is definitely a spot you have to keep an eye on the mini-map in case of a core rush, because look how far you guys are from your core. So if they decide to do a core rush, you gotta be ready to hearth back right away. And this is another reason not to be caught out. You cannot help him, probably. Oh my goodness. See, now, the issue with this is there is no damage around here. Your damage is Butcher and Vala, and none of them are here to follow up on it. In this case, I probably would have just let Tassadar die, unfortunately. I mean, you never want to let your teammates die, but I think that would have been the way to go. Let's take a look at it. All right, so here's when you start to head over there. You have 1, 2, 3, 4 at least over here, and you're basically diving into a 1v4, and that's just, there's just, especially with death timer so long, this is, I don't think this is a move you want right here. Because Tassadar died anyway, and then their ETC goes. Yeah, I think the move there was definitely just to let Tassadar die, unfortunately. Now, these two need to realize that you have to be back right now. Red team should be just going straight to core right now, with it already at 59%. I don't know why they're not. and there's no reason to be this far forward. You know, we have Blue's vision right here. You kind of have to operate on the assumption that anytime you don't see the enemy, they're coming to kill you. And if you take that perspective in mind when you're playing, nice, that was a great peeling Reign of Vengeance. She just completely saved Lili's life and got a free kill on Artanis. Great save, Ollie. But if you go with the mentality of the enemy is not here, that means that they're going to kill me, you'll save yourself a lot of avoidable deaths. And that's really one of the quickest ways to improve as a player, is eliminating avoidable deaths as much as possible. This is the old March of the Murlocs, of course. Still does a ton of damage. As you can see, Giggleschmack just ate the entire... Let's look at that again. This is when I think a simple pathing issue would have avoided a lot of damage. Look at how much... When ETC spawns, watch how much damage Giggle eats from the March of the Murlocs. Okay, right. So here's the March coming. He's at full health. Now, it ends right here. You could have just gone this way pretty easily, right around the backside instead of right through. But look at the damage. A half a health bar, more than half a health bar, by walking through the March of the Murlocs. And then the slow. I think the slow actually made it to where you would have been faster going around. You would have been farther forward than walking in a straight line. Nice. You guys want to push this and get a keep in the game. Problem is, every time you guys kill them, you haven't gotten any structural advantage out of it. One person babysit Murky, the rest of you guys go do something.
Your core is under attack, heroes.
Oh man, that Murky is just trolling you guys.
More bones for the mines.
Once again, if they're off the minimap, they're trying to jump you, and you guys are kind of all over the place. Part of that is that you have to chase Murky all over, and that you're being constantly forced to defend. But despite all that, you managed to agree to secure a stronger golem than the other team. Granted, you have double mercs pushing down, and you cannot let these suicide ones go for it. I mean, this Murky is just harassing you guys. Look at all the damage. Holy moly. Make sure you're giving attack speed to Butcher and Volley. Or at least, maybe not both, but at least one. There you go. Okay, so 3-1 golems by your team, and you only have one fort damage. Which is why I strongly dislike this map. Okay, so now, what we need to be thinking is ETC is exactly right. Apoc was down. Once he popped that Apoc, that's like your license to go in there and hit that mosh pit.
Mega kill.
Once again, one person on defense, everyone else get a keep.
Your core is under attack, heroes.
Yeah, see, Butcher's got D, so let him do it. He just called it. Everyone else push. And if I'm you guys, look at all the time you're wasting on minions. Just go straight to that keep. Ignore all of this. Ignore all of this and go get that keep. Don't grab the camps. You guys, as a four, will do more damage than the camps will. So the four of you, Vala, Lili, ETC, and Tassadar, simply need to group and get on keep. Look, we have 15 seconds till the whole team is up back again. Granted, that murky kill is nice. 15 seconds till the whole team is back up again, and you guys haven't even crossed halfway across the map yet. You really want to take advantage of these late game team fight wins. Ping that keep like crazy. Because you guys have spent so much time clearing out these dominion waves. See, now you guys can't fight us three, though. They have four people up. The opportunity has gone. Until Vala or Butcher get here, you can't fight up here. Yep, now it's disengage time. Because so much time was spent killing Murky's eggs, getting the Murk camps, and clearing the lanes that you guys almost lost your opportunity. Well, you did lose that opportunity. Now you got to get another opportunity by securing another team fight win. That was a great power slide. Now granted, you guys keep crushing them in team fights, so you keep getting these chances, but you just haven't been able to capitalize on it. Okay, now ignore Diablo and get the key. Yes, good call. You're the tank, man, get in there. No, you need to tank that, not Tassadar. Get in there. Whoa, why are we bringing retreat? Tass is dead. Everyone else get in here and burn this thing down. There, at least now the pressure is equalized, right? Now at least you only have one lane that you're losing. This is a core call. This is absolutely a core call. Yep, for sure. Okay, at this level 24, how many people do we have here? Let's do a little experiment. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4 heroes here with no katas, and we're at 2757. How long does it take them to burn the core? The other thing to keep in mind is the core does splash damage. So if you guys all group up like that, you're all taking the damage together. You want to spread out just a little bit. There you go. So 2757 to 20, it took them 11 seconds at, and this is why at this late in the game, when you get that advantage, don't get the minions, don't get the mercs, don't kill the murky egg, go get that keep. Because you guys saw how quickly, 11 seconds it took the four of you to burn through the core. So why waste all that time burning through all the minions? You guys could have gotten that keep a long time ago. So the main thing that I would take from this game is how much split pushers really can do a lot of damage if you don't account for them. The late game, you guys accounted for them really well because you had to. You had to because they were putting pressure on the core. But in the early game, you guys kept going and getting the skulls, and they just ignored them and took structures out. But the other thing, too, and this is definitely a difference you'll see at higher level plays, higher level players punish the opposition team when they win team fights, and that was something you guys didn't do until this very last one. You would win these team fights 3-4 kills and then wouldn't turn it into something. You really want to turn those team fight wins into something, and not just clearing out lanes or getting camps. You can burn those forts and those keeps way faster than the merc camps can, so try to really pound that down. I mean, if your teammates don't go with you, you can't do it. But try to assume that leadership role and lead the charge into those keeps. Take those things down. But that was a really nice game with how frustrating would it be to blue team if you lose that game 35 kills to 10? That's certainly not what you want there. you know, especially when you're structurally behind like that, you have to seize upon those opportunities to even out that structural disadvantage. So that's when you got to win those team fights and go get something. Go get something out of it. There's no boss on this one, so you can't boss it here, but go get those forts and keeps. And you guys had two or three chances to do it that you didn't take advantage of it.
Lucio coming at you!
All right, second one is a gold level, and it's on Rhaegar. So our hero for this game will be, I am not a daredevil on Rhaegar. And hey, he's here with us. Always love to see guys here live. So welcome. I don't know if you were here the first time we did your replay live. So if you weren't, glad you could make it. But I mean, that last core call where you guys just burned it down so fast is like such a perfect illustration of how quickly high-level heroes can destroy structures. I think that's not something that's taken advantage of as much as it should be at lower levels, right? Those were level 24 heroes, and four of them burned down the core in 11 seconds. So keep that in the back of your head when you're considering what to do in these late-game situations. Well, we went from my second least favorite map to my first least favorite map, and that is Warhead Junction. So Warhead Junction, we need to keep in mind, one, it is huge. This map is absolutely bonkers large. Rhaegar is another one of those heroes that has two perfectly viable ultimates, and so you really should have it in your head which one you're going to do. Ancestral is kind of always good. Bloodlust, though, is something you want to use if you have auto attackers on your team, and in that case, that would be Tez Dingo. I don't think you could go wrong, to be perfectly honest, in this comp. However, if Tyrael went Sanctification, I would strongly consider Bloodlust, simply because they kind of, it would be a little redundant, give you guys a little more damage. Rhaegar is also an interesting healer because he can get in there and mix it up a little bit, but you don't want to, especially like looking at our comp, we have four melees. Valyra doesn't really count because she's going to be kind of moving around the back line and doing her stealthy thing. But if you have multiple melees already and you play in the front with Rhaegar, you can really clog it up. So you really want to pick your spots when to use that wolf bite. Also because you're a healer, you're a priority target for the other team. So if you play too aggressively in the front line and you make yourself vulnerable to being attacked by the opponent's team, that's a detriment to your team. So as Rhaegar, you really want to pick your spots when you're going to get in there and wolf bite. Because it's something you want to take advantage of, right? If you don't use that ability, it's wasted. It's really great in pursuit, and if you can kind of selectively use it in the midst of a fight, that's fantastic as well. Also, in the case of Valyra, I would consider using it if she isolates out a target, you know, does her stun or silence, that's a good follow-up too to get in there and wolf fight. The other thing, anytime you're playing a hero, nice, this is a great start for you guys. Anytime you're playing a healer, you want to try to figure out who your priority target is, who's going to be getting most of your attention. And you also, anytime you have Zul'jin, you want to be aware your Zul'jin player probably doesn't want to be at full health a lot, and he also has self-sustain. If he wants to heal up, he can simply back out and heal up. So don't top off your Zul'jin player necessarily. He may not want it. If he's at half health, just hang there. And this is something I focus out a lot. The laning phase, the primary goal of the laning phase is to stay alive and soak safely. And you're fighting two heroes here in Rag and Lili, so you're going to lose the lane, and that's okay. stay alive and soak. If you burn too much more mana here, when those nukes pop up, you're not going to have the mana to help your team fight over those nukes. So you want to make sure that you have enough mana. I think you're going to go tap here. Fantastic. But don't burn through that to the point where you can't help your team in the objective battles. All of this is great. This is just safely soaking, staying out of trouble, not doing anything silly. That's a lot of free damage taken there. Yeah, and this is exactly what we didn't want to see. I like that you came out to kill a heal, but now you have to hearth back right as these nukes popped, and that's really not a great time to have to do that. It's on Warhead Junk. I don't usually talk about builds too much, and I love Colossal Totem at 1. However, on this map specifically, I would have considered the increase in the speed simply because of how big the map is and you're going to be rotating all over the place. You probably would have gotten a lot of use out of that increased speed bonus. Nice healing totem. Now, I love what you did there, which is you supported Dahaka as much as you could without getting yourself in a really bad spot. That Dahaka was going to die. He's fighting 1-on-3. It was not a very wise decision. So you stayed close enough to support him without getting yourself in trouble too, and maybe you help him get lucky. But ultimately, that was a 3-on-2, and that's just not a fight you want to take. So I love what you did there. You supported him, you healed him, you put the lightning shield on him, but didn't get yourself in trouble. Oh, well now though, this warhead's still down here, so this is where we need to be. See, with Rhaegar still. I'm sorry, if. Yeah, and that, now you guys have Pithlaw. Oh no, hey, she got in there and got it. Good on Valir. It's worked out for you guys, but I always want to. One of the hardest things to do in Hero League is get your team moving in the same direction, and one of the ways to do that is making sure you show up for the objectives. That helps your team have faith in you. Nice low, that's a great follow-up slowing totem. Really nicely done. And this is where this wolf move speed would have come in handy. Yeah, you don't want to run through that for sure. So you guys are in kind of a dicey spot here. This is a really bad place to be. She can get away with it because of her stealth, but running up here like you did, this is a very tough spot to be in. Nice kill on Raynor, and way to get out. Way to make me eat my words. She'll make me sure I don't know what I'm talking about. You know, something to remember is just because it turns out okay, that doesn't necessarily mean it was the right decision. So, there you go. Oh, you had a heal up too. That's disappointing. Yeah, I said Rengar is one of the trickier heroes for positioning because you want to get aggressive and do some damage. He can do damage, but you also don't want to put yourself in a spot to get yourself killed, right? Because think about it from the perspective of team fighting, right? We're always trying to get to the other team's healer, so don't give them that gift by out of position and allowing yourself to be attacked. Now this is a great spot. Once again, really good totem there. If that was almost anybody other than Muradin, that would have been really well done. Although I'm going to go back a little bit and we're going to see if we can make that from we're going to see if we can improve our efficiency on that play a little bit more. Are you here yet? Yeah, okay, a little bit more. I think there's one thing we could have done there that would have made that a little bit better and maybe pick up the kill. Let's see. Okay. So when you come in, right now you're running from over here. You see Valyra's doing her thing. All of this is great. Okay. So now I think, let's find out if you do this. Okay, the one thing I would have done differently is this. Is once you use an ability, you lose your wolf form. So I would have liked to have seen to use the wolf bite first, so you get that extra damage, and then throw down the healing totem. That might have made the difference. So you bite first, totem second. That way you get your bonus damage from being in wolf form. Maybe, maybe not. But bite first, totem second, so you get that extra damage in. I'm curious to see which heroic you decide here. I said I don't think either one is wrong. There you go, you did it right there too. The bite and then the slow. Perfect. Although, now we're going to do one more. We're going to add on one more to that little combo here. And once again, maybe it makes a difference. Would have been close. Alright, so you go in wolf form, all of this is great. So you go to wolf bite, that's perfect. You throw them the totem, perfect. And then you keep pursuing. Now, this is when you alt W. You get that lightning shield on yourself, so as you're chasing Muradin, it's doing damage other than just your auto attack. So right here, alt W. So imagine this lightning shield as you're running after him, smacking him the whole way. See, a little bit late. But this time you did it perfect. You did the bite and then the ancestral, which is great. I hope you're too far from your backliners here. I hope the ancestral's coming right here. But either way, we always want to evaluate these team fights, and you got 3-on-3, so this is okay. Here. Now you guys should be able to secure this. I like how you're kind of bobbing, weaving, and out of here, not overly committing to get yourself into trouble. Now this is a tough spot here. This is when I would consider throwing down the slowing totem, because you guys are kind of all over the place, and until Zul'jin gets here, you're going to be in a slightly rough spot. Yep, and now right there, once Dahaka goes down, that's your guys' cue to leave. Everybody should be leaving. So what I would like you to be doing is I'd like you to be somewhere in here. Maybe you can use your totem and your heal to get Zul'jin out alive. At least he took one with him. Now you guys are 2-for-2.
Still got it.
Still nobody has gotten that? Nope, nobody has gotten that. That's a great combo by Tyrael and Valyra on.
Thanks, friend.
Yeah, wait for Valera. This is where you want to wait for her to set it up for you. So patience. I like that move, getting it off you so you can channel another one. Really nicely done. Okay, that I think was a little bit of a misplay there. If Ancestral was off, with Ancestral better early than late. I mean, I know sometimes these epic, like last minute life changing Ancestrals are like awesome. But when I'm looking at this, you have it off as soon as it comes off cooldown right here. That's when I'm hitting him with it. Right there, as soon as it comes off cooldown. It might have been too late anyway. It was just close enough. There you go, that was a great Ancestral though, at least. Oh, that's a aggressive position, you want to be careful with that. So you ended up getting great value out of Ancestral anyway, which is fantastic. Boy, this was a long, drawn-out battle here. You guys really going back and forth here. And that's the advantage of Rag. See, if Tyrael's right, if you would have only used one, you could have saved the second one for when Rag was done. Those are the things that are a little bit harder to talk about, though, in a solo team league. Like, if you're on comms, it's a little easier to talk about that kind of stuff. But solo hero league is definitely a little bit harder. Oh, the Sulfurous Smash crushed you guys. Not a bad Sank to get everybody out. I like the calls for retreat, and I like you letting them know how low on mana you are. So you guys are in a pretty good spot. Pretty good spot here. I'm not sure what Dahaka's doing up here. That's a wasted Dark Swarm there. That was bizarre. That was really weird. Just channel again. Nope, now you get it though. Almost a great Ancestral, but now you gotta leave. See, right here, looking at the mini-map, you've got zero chance of doing anything. This is a full-blown retreat here. Don't even go back in there. Yeah, just leave. Look at that mini-map, there's four of them up here. There you go. Now your team's coming, you can re-engage. Although no tank, you guys have no tank, and there's four of them. So probably shouldn't even engage up here at all. Good patience. Once again, still four up here, so that means no engagement. Now you can though. 16 to 14, 4-on-4, this is the engagement you take, and Tyrael's on his way. And he has Holy Ground, or should. Yes, he does. Nice Ancestral, great Ancestral. Everything looking great for you guys, and I like that you didn't dive in there. By the way, this is a great spot for your... Oh, you put it perfect time. Look, as soon as I started to say, throw the totem down, it's exactly what you did. Nicely done. Not too crazy. There you go. I love that dodge, the diving in and out you're doing there, not staying in harm's way, just getting the bite off. Okay, perfect. Retreat pings, everybody leaves. Yeah, make that rag waste that that molten core there. Structurally, up in level a little bit now, although it looks like Valera was caught out there.
Capably done, team.
Yeah, watch the minimap, right? We know where they all are. You can't take this engagement here. Don't go in there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 3. Yep, get out. And that's exactly why. Yeah, and you know, even this is too close. There's just no reason to be up there. I want to see retreat pings from everybody here. This is a 5-on-4. All of that happened because of taking an engagement when you're outnumbered. It's something you almost never ever want to do. Don't chase. Just throw the heal on Tyrael to keep him up. But don't go out and get yourself dead yet. The other thing I want to look at. So this is something. Now that Earth, the lightning shield actually gives a shield, don't forget that. Be aware. That it almost gives you another support talent, right? So if you think that shield is going to be good, you can use it not just for damage, but also for the shield. And prioritize your tanks with that shield because it's a percentile-based ability. And this saltiness of Tyrael is just not helpful. I like that your decision here. You're not going to do anything by yourself down there. You may as well go clear out of camp. Now, once your team is up, though, now you got to go join them down there. If they're starting to maneuver down there, and you just saw the rotation coming, I hope we're backing up now. They're coming up. We just saw them on the minimap. Get your slow one to Rhaegar or Rainer if you can. There you go. Now that's that's actually a perfect example of what, and it probably wouldn't have made a difference. He probably would have died anyway. But this is a good example of the dynamic I was talking about, right? You guys kill Rainer, everything's good. Now you throw a heal on somebody, that's fine. But now look at Dehaka right here. He's in trouble. The W here is health for him, it's a shield. So use that W as a shielding talent. Right? If it's on cooldown, it didn't do much of any good. Yeah, well... Stop dying is not constructive, right? You need to figure out why the person die. What they did that made it a bad decision to engage. And oh, so low, Rhaegar. That's about as much as I think you're gonna get out of that life form. So rather than saying stop dying, you need to address the underlying symptom of the death. You know, boy, hey, this is brutal in here. But that's not something you can do in a game with your teammates very much. It's hard to do that. To address the symptoms of why they're dying in the first place. Because some people don't take it the right way. When I've been on support, I've had my teammates, you know, where they get attacked and they run away from me and I'm trying to chase them down to heal them. So I've said, hey, don't run from me, run to me when you need healing. This is a great spot for your W right here. There you go. And way to put it on the tank for sucking in all that damage. Nice and done. Throw your healing totem out there though, everybody could use it. There you go. Storm shield, good. That's kind of what I wanted to see. Now once again, there you go. Now you know they're at the bottom, and you only see two of them, now three of them. One is dead, so one is missing. You should be okay. Always try to interpret that minimap as much as you can to make sure you're not in a position to get yourself into trouble.
Enemy fort destroyed.
Now, if you guys are going to get this boss, you really want to get a keep at it. That's what we want to see. I agree. That's a good call. Tyrael, push with it. You guys have two nukes and a boss, so you have a great opportunity here to get some damage. This, though, this is where minimap watching is so important. If you guys push with and you don't realize that Zul'jin is down here and not with you, that could be trouble. So you need to be aware that Zul'jin is not with you guys. However, as long as Rainer is showing top, there's your 4-on-4. I like that you held the nuke, wait for Rag, nicely done. Surprised you guys aren't trying to put a little more pressure with the boss there, but I would have liked to have seen you guys try to pressure a little more with the boss once that Rag was down. Although the safe call, not necessarily the wrong call. But for two bosses, you guys basically got one keep wall in exchange for two bosses, so not a lot of value there. Yeah, whatever this medium was. So good response to their push down there. All right, so now hopefully with the Dahaka global, you guys will have an advantage here. So once again, one of those things where we want to make sure we are aware where all of our teammates are. We know, we just saw at least three of the bad guys somewhere up in here, and it looks like Valera is going to try to sneak the bottom one. So you're going to be without Valera for the first go of this. And you guys are really scattered. See, Dahaka coming down here I think was a little bit unnecessary, but if this goes like it's going, you guys are at worst going to get two. So not the end of the world. Each team gets two. Oh, just kidding. Why did nobody pick this up? What happened there? They didn't actually grab it down there. That was weird. Huh. Splitting, though, when you're down structurally is a little bit problematic. Don't know why. Both Dahaka and Valera were bottom. I don't know why they didn't grab it. I like the retreat calls here. You guys are way split up. Throw a heal on him. Nice low.
My thanks to you,
healer. There, Valera finally got it. See, now that I was just going to say, this is what needs to be careful of. They have two nukes to drop on core. And you guys don't really have a way of getting him out of it. I already used one. Nice Ancestral. Better early than late. Storm Shield! Storm Shield! Oh no! That's... Wow. Let's take a look at that team fight, because there was a lot going on there. This was, I think, the first time this game that you're positioning a little too far forward and it came back to kind of bite you a little, because there were a couple times I pointed out throughout the game where I thought you were in a dangerous position and the red team just was never able to punish you for it. And I think this was the first time you really got punished for being a little bit too far forward.
My health is renewed.
So let's see here. Where is everybody? 1, 2, 3, 4. So this isn't bad, but ideally your front line is here. So you should be down here, right? Positioned behind your tanks. You know Valera is going to come in at the top. See, once again, though, Tyrael's in the back line, and that's not where he wants to be. So be very wary of crossing your front line. There, now look how forward you are. Right in the midst of everybody. That's, I think, this is a problem. And that Ancestral was perfect. And now, okay, this is what I want to see here, is when he goes that Sanct, walk in there. See, look, you look at how much damage you take standing outside of the Sanctification, and there's no CC on you. And I actually noticed it earlier in this game, and I should have said something as well. When Tyrael pops that Sanctification, utilize it. Get in there.
Alert. Your core is under attack.
Right? So let's see, right? He's gonna pop it right here. One. So no CC, no CC, no CC. Look at all that free damage that was taken by standing just outside of the Sanctification. So that was the error at the end game for you, was you have all of this area of places where you're gonna be perfectly healthy. And instead, you stood just outside of that and Sonya leapt on you. And once you got that crater on you, there, I mean, you were just... Combined with the Ragnaros and the Cups and the Sulphurous Smash, your team just got wrecked. Now, the way that team fight went there at the end, if you stood in the Sanct and lived an extra 5 to 10 seconds, it probably wouldn't have mattered the way this team fight went down. Because what probably would have happened instead is Sonya wouldn't have leaped on you until the Sanctification expired, and she probably leaps on all three of you, and the three of you maybe get Sulphurous Smashed. So, but in general, if you can get inside that Sanctification, you most definitely want it. So I actually thought you played a pretty good game. A lot of these games I look at, there's a lot of avoidable, kind of foolish deaths, and you really didn't have any of those. You know, this last one, you could have gone in the Sanct and saved yourself a little time. Your healing numbers, I mean, were excellent. The damage is a little bit low. When I play Rhaegar, kind of my goal damage is 20k. It's not the end of the world. You were pretty close. But the main things I would take from this is be more aware of your positioning and evaluating those team fights. Even though you only died two times in this, I think there were probably another two to three times where you got yourself in a little bit of a hairy spot and it turned out okay for you because you were able to get away. But maybe in other games that wouldn't be the case. So really be sure to not take those engagements where things are going to go bad. You know, if there's a 4-on-3 and you're down a talent tier, that's just not a fight you want to take. And, you know, unless the game is going to actually be over, just don't be there. Go do something else. In Hero League, it can be tough because sometimes your teammates will put you in those situations. And in that case, you kind of have to take it on a case-by-case basis, right? If your teammates are all going in to do something silly and you can't talk them out of it, I guess you should probably go with them, but just be aware that it maybe wasn't the best decision in that moment. So thank you to Giggle Schmack and I'm Not Daredevil for submitting the replays. I really appreciate it. Hope everybody has a great night. I am casting a Chair League a couple times this week, so be sure to check the schedule, which will be up on my Twitch once the stream goes off. Have a wonderful night, everybody, and thank you for tuning in.